So, in today's lectures, we will first be talking about training neural networks. Especially, we will discuss about classification problems via convolutional neural networks. So, we have two sections today. So, first, let's start talk about classification problem in neural networks. So, the loss function is the most important tool that we actually help us to train the model and to achieve the best accuracy that we can. So the loss function that we will use for classification problems is cross entropy loss. Okay, so cross entropy loss actually actually works on a softmax output. So let's start with what is softmax means. So in the last lecture, Alex talked about mathematical explanation of what is cross entropy and the soft and how we can derive softmax. So actually, softmax we have an objective that we want to classify. Okay, so for each input x, the output of the network y that it indicates probability measure over the set elements of the class. Then we have actually we choose the arg max of our outputs. Okay, where the outputs the y actually are probabilistic output. And then we normalize our output layer to a probability from 1 to 0. And we choose the maximum element, which indicates our guess. Okay? Then, when we actually have our guess, it will be y, it's our trained model guess. Then we want to minimize him to our given output. Okay, so we do it with cross entropy. Cross entropy is actually a version of L2 square error MSE to classification problems. Okay, and then we want to minimize the distance between the true label and the predicted label. Okay. So the loss function, the cross entropy function, is represented like this. Okay, minus log y to t. When t is actually our t is indicator where ct is the correct label. So. Neural networks are usually over-specified because we designed to have more parameters than the number of training samples, in most cases. So it's usually a bad idea to consider a model as classical learning theory. So the add more weights and more layers, in most cases we actually overfit our model, and then we need to use regularization methods for close the gaps between the training prediction and the test inference prediction. Okay, so here we can actually see what is overfitting problem here. So design a network that is big enough does not underfit or train data. Okay, so what we actually want is that our training plot. Training line and the validation line will be close as possible. Okay? And in this case, which we can see that here we starting out on our overview. Okay? Because our model, the red line is actually the validation error, and the blue one is the training error. So we want. So here we have underfitting. Okay, overfitting. So overfitting is actually we train, we classify our training samples better than we do it on a validation set or unviewable set. That it's actually samples that model never see. Okay. So we want that our model will classify the viewed samples and unviewed samples in the same rate. Okay. So, this is actually what expected, and overfitting is the case when he do better on the training set and worse on the validation set. The other options is actually underfitting. Underfitting is when he learn better on the validation set than rather than on training set. It's another opposite, and in this case our accuracy is worse in the same rates as in overfitting. So regularize it's so it will be not overfit on validation. It's what actually we want to do. There are a lot of regularization techniques. It's very interesting research that a lot of researchers are dealing with developing new methods to for doing better regularization technique and avoid other overfitting on large scale problems. So early stopping is simple. It's a simple method. It means that to avoid overfitting by deciding to stop the training procedure according to measured validation loss. So when our validation loss are stopped to decreasing, we actually finish our training. Okay. Unregularized models tend to get worse at some point on the validation set, while still getting better on the training set. So it could be one of the problems. So the other regularization techniques is the data augmentation. So data augmentation, it's actually a technique that must be fitted to our data. So if we are dealing with specification of pixels, we want to do our augmentation from a computer vision area. So we will rotate them and make some projections, adding some white noising and other stuff that we can do on our data to learn model to be less vulnerable to change, to be more vulnerable to change that could be in our settings. Okay, so we can add some Gaussian noises or vision tasks. Okay, so one of the most important regularization techniques that we use is weight decay. So weight decay is actually L2. L2 is actually MSE regularization technique that we use on our weights. Yes. So we actually add to our weights some parameter, that will give you some normalization in terms of L2. This technique, normalization, weight normalization, actually give very phenomenal results and help a lot to model converge and to training process to be to decrease the number of epochs that we need for learning process. Okay. So the equivalent of the Gecko weights is in each gradient descent. Yes.
It's not when the neuron has a very high molecular value.
Yeah.
But the signal function is getting vanishes. So is the L2 parameterization what it's being needed in that case?
Okay, so your question is if we are using
sigmoid
activations and not well activations, if L2 normalization, actually I'm talking about BDK, yes? It's not batch normalization, it's not technique that we apply on our activations. It's the technique that we apply on our weights, yeah?
Yes, but if, for example, if the neuron has a high entry value, it can advance. So if there is already a normalization, big weights and large.
Yeah, okay. So this is really good question. I think that we will deal with it later when we will talk about some specific neural network model, specifically convolutional neural network and recurrent neural network. We will talk about activation that we will use there. But let's assume that it's not depend weight decay normalization is not depend on your activation function. Okay, so actually this technique works for all activation functions we use, and relevant is actually a simple case. It's one of the activation functions, but of any non-linearity. Non-near linearity function, it will work. Okay, so it doesn't matter. It's actually look. This function makes our weights distribute Gaussian to be Gaussian distributed in the network. So and it's helped to again it helped to a layer to converge. Okay. It's not defined to our non-linearity. Okay, but actually we use in conventional neural network because with the document sigmoid function we'll talk about later. What is the empirical reason? Yeah.
Can you please explain again why weight decay prevents
overfitting? Why he prevents overfitting? Yeah, I saw this. Why he prevented it. Okay, so it's empirically, the explanation will be empirical. So overfitting, what actually weight decay do? Okay, he makes our weights in each layer to be distributed in normal in Gaussian. It makes our weights to be Gaussian distributed. And normal, okay. So working with normalized weights, actually, it's decrease the range of our learning. So decrease the number of values. It actually gives us better opportunity if it works in some subset of solutions. Small subset is we can achieve a better result. Yeah, when we work on some subset of solutions, actually, we help us. We know where the optimization will happen. We know our range of our range of gradients is already smaller. Okay, it's help to model to learn better. Okay. Yeah.
Let's say we set the weights initially to big outs and distributed.
Okay.
And we set effort to be very high, so there will be no change in the network.
Yeah. Okay. 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 So, if we said first, it's not a good initialization. In most cases we not set them in attitude very high. Okay, we can set our weights to be normally distributed, but there are no promises that it will. There are no promises that it will actually remain in the end of the process. Yeah. The initialization of weights without using weight decay, there are no promises on the distribution will be remained the same because we are using gradient descent. There are no promises. Okay. Good. So, weight decay is one of the regularization techniques. Now, I will show you the dropout. Dropout is actually very common technique, mostly used in convolutional neural networks. Big convolutional neural networks that have a lot of layers and parameters. In this case, we actually have when we use very over-parameterized network, we actually have overfitting on our dataset, on our training. So dropout actually give us its set. Zero on some of the connections between one layer and the other layer, and actually give us so that's inconsistent the noise signal. We actually you can use or Bernoulli or Gaussian distribution of which of the connections we actually turn off. Okay, if we actually set dropout with 0.5, it's actually the health of our parameter, the health of our connections between one layer and the other layer is set to zero. Okay? It's in this case we can remove our underfitting and fit in our overfitting. How we do it? Because in the system, in the model that overfitting, it means that most of our parameters learned to classify the training data. Yeah, and when we actually give less. We should give less parameters to the training dataset, so it gives us better results on the validation set. Okay, so dropout is actually to set zero on some of connections. Okay, between one layer and the other layer. Yeah.
The dropout is performed before or after the nonlinear
union? The dropout is performed. The dropout can be as before. It actually doesn't matter. Okay, you can use it before on the after activation function. Yeah, because actually in the convolutional neural networks we mostly use in RHEL. So RHEL, what RHEL does, it will be later slide, but relevant is actually to transfer only the positive neurons. So it doesn't matter. You can use it on the on dropout. You can use dropout before or after. Usually we use it after, but there are no really some justification. Okay. Yeah.
Do you randomize zero connections for every fold or once?
Yes, you randomize for you randomize it for every fold, yeah, because you want some distribution over the training process. You don't want to you want it in every process you go to distribute it again. Yeah.
Is the idea of robot a little bit like bagging or not really?
Again,
is the idea of dropout a little bit like bagging, bagging in random forest, like?
Yeah. I think that the dropout is came from this idea. I think it came from bagging in your office. Yeah. But actually, look, the dropout it's not decreased as the number of parameters. Yeah. It's not decreased. The network remains the same. We actually only what we do some of the transform if we have actually transform function from one layer to another. We set zero in some places.
Because you're trying to teach different parts of the network.
Yes, because we want to teach some of the other parts. We want to that every part will be teach in the same way. So we drop it from Gaussian distribution. So we want
to,
yeah.
Is set to zero throughout the entire training or just for one?
No, for that, yeah. You actually, the dropout evolved in all training processes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The dropout is evolved for all the training processes.
Okay, Adam, do you re-magrill metadash?
We choose the distribution again. And again, every. Okay. So now we can. This is the visualization of our dropout. So the standard neural network looks like this. It's actually two. It's actually a perceptron, yeah, with one hidden layer, and in the chart B, we actually see the applying dropout. So some of the connections are actually set to be zero. Okay.
It's very drastic. Is this a real example?
Hmm?
Is this a real example?
No. Of course not at all. It's very drastic. It's very hard. It's a very hard dropout.
Well, so
actually, technically we use in common the dropout with factor of 0.2.3. It's a common dropout parameter. But so there a lot of explanation for the success of the dropout. It's encouraged to redundancy with the network that there cannot be high dependencies on the specific unit or set units. Okay, the second one is actually we can see the average technique as two square n. Different models are used under expectation when evaluating. And the third, the multiplicative noise, okay, can allow better generalization. It's similar to data augmentation. So again, using dropout, we can emulate it as adding some noise for our network. So and when we actually add noise, we make our model to be vulnerable for change and its major actor more working well. So it's one of the experiments.
Question?
Yeah.
Are there techniques that the regularization is, the dropout is not randomized, but with some strategy, like trying to, like the first bullets, run without a dropout and then start performing dropout when you have...
Okay, you asked me about strategy, what is the strategy of using the regularization models?
Yeah.
It depends on your model that you use.
Because still randomization on the dropout is not... it's like tossing a coin. Why not performing dropout with some strategy? Like trying to create a similar converge on each layer or something like that.
Okay, so this is good. This is really good questions. Look, historically, dropout comes as one of the first regularization techniques.
Yeah.
Okay, so historically, it happens only 5 years ago, but it's like it's history So yeah.
So do you still use the very same strategy if your architecture is very, very depending on the layers? Like if it's all layers are equal, I can understand. It's basically, but if you have like multiple kinds of layers, so do you still just use?
Okay, so first using dropout is very tricky, okay? Because dropouts can very harm your performance, and actually very high parameter of the dropout can actually make your model to diverge very fast. So actually this technique, dropout, comes after, I want to talk about it later when we will discuss about types. Okay, so let's for now continue, okay? Because actually this technique was developed for deal with convolutional neural networks like AlexNet and VGGNet. So let's talk about it later in the context of convolutional neural network. Okay, thanks. Okay, so now we will continue with the optimization that we do on neural networks. As the optimization of networks can be very challenging, as we actually try to figure out. When we deal with highly non-complex problem, when we actually need to find some assurance to model convert. Yeah? So our problem can be observed in very simple non-complex error landscape. Okay, you can see it here, okay? Okay. So, our some obvious difficult of assurance of convergence of this kind of problem is strong dependencies on initial weights. Yeah, when we talk about initial data, possibly poor estimation of leading to noisy gradients. Exploring very high dimensional space using only local information. Okay, so one of the basic and the most popular optimizers is actually SGD. Okay, last class we talked about gradient descent and why it actually works. Today I will present you the stochastic gradient descent. It's actually a strategy that we use in neural network models. Okay, we have some other upgrades to this algorithm, but this is actually the classic algorithm and it's actually most useful. Okay, so what is our strategy? So the strategy worked this way. We actually, the updating rule of this algorithm is the wake in time plus one will be the existing wake minus epsilon. It's actually our learning wake, we're talking about it now, multiply by gradient, okay? So where W is optimized parameter, okay, weight, and E is actually our error loss, okay? So loss function, we talked about if it's classification problem, so it's cross entropy, and epsilon is learning rate, okay? So, great. It's usually helpful to anneal the learning rate over time. Okay, so we start from one learning rate, and then we actually decrease it, okay? Because we actually, the motivation for decreasing our learning rate, that if we think that we actually get closer to our global minimum, yeah? So we don't want to jump over the global minimum. So if we have actually a lot of local minimums, yeah, and we have one global minimum, and let's assume that we have only one global minimum. So then we actually start from some high parameter of learning rate, and then we actually for the time that we're getting closer to our local minimum, global minimum, we actually decrease it. In the final stage, we want to achieve our global minimum and to converge to the best efforts. Okay, so actually our step decay is watching the validation error while training with a fixed learning rate. Reduce the learning rate by a constant whenever the validation error stops improving. Okay. So it's one of the strategies for the for working with the learning rate. The other strategy is exponential decay. Is actually where we actually set some parameter. Yeah, exponential parameter and our learning rate decrease. With this parameter. And another strategy is actually the smooth decay, that we're actually smoothing it by dividing on some decay, on some function, okay? Okay, so good learning rate achieves us for the red line, okay? So it's in over time, we actually decrease in our loss error, and finally we achieve the maximum, the global minimum and the maximum accuracy. Okay, the green line actually represent high learning rate. Okay, it's not represent high learning rate when we are not using the strategy of decreasing learning rate. And our learning rate actually give, and we actually in the high learning rate we actually jumping from one local minimum to other local minimum. Yes, so it's actually like we are jumping from one local minimum to other local minimum because we can achieve the global minimum. Okay, because the step is large, is very large. Okay, very high. Okay. So the blue line represents low learning rate. In the final, we will converge for the same. In the low learning rate and good learning rate, we actually will converge to the same results like as in a red line, but it will take more inputs. Okay. So very high learning rate will give us full divergence, and it will diverge very fast. Okay, so is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay, so momentum is actually a parameter that help us to find actually the direction of gradient descent. Yeah? And actually the parameter is set to understand the, in which direction we must go for decrease, optimize function in a better way. So momentum update is an approach that almost always enjoy better converge rates on deep learning. This update can be motivated like a trajectory on error surface as a ball rolling down here. Okay? So we actually find that in each step, we actually find the fastest way to down of our hill, and we actually go to this direction. Okay, this way we can accelerate our optimization process, our training process, and to find actually to make better update loop. Okay, so smoothing any regression in other direction. So the SGD with momentum, we can actually update our SGD algorithm is using the momentum, and first we calculate our momentum v in the next iteration in the next time. So it's some mu is hyperparameter momentum hyperparameter multiplied by vt. Existing vt is actually our existing slope, yeah, and then we actually multiply it by momentum hyperparameter in this step form, and then we actually minus our learning rate multiplied by derivative of loss function. So this adding this parameter to update rules give us better and highest converge. So it actually gives us opportunity to train a model faster.
Why do you use VT plus one and not VT?
Where?
In the second line.
Because you here?
Yes.
Because you want actually okay. Because you update your WT in what actually done in the previous period, yeah, and here it's the slope of this step, because you're updating the t plus one step. Okay. First you find your vt plus one.
Well, this is for the next iteration.
Yeah, but this is the next iteration.
Okay.
So it's actually. The update of this iteration is based on the momentum in this iteration correct in the next iteration. Okay. Wait. Yeah.
Can you go backwards?
Yes.
So basically, it's just the gradient descent L. If I'm looking at the second equation,
yeah.
So it's the normal gradient descent L, but only with added mu vt in the uptake.
Yes, yes. It's the difference for using the momentum.
Okay.
It's only yeah. So again, you add with. Actually, with momentum, we actually add one more parameter. Yeah, and this parameter, this parameter actually indicate your faster direction to the to your yeah to the faster the faster direction to your local mean local mean. Yeah.
It's basically if you unroll it the history of the gradient and you assume that first you were okay. Right?
Yeah.
That's how you can see it?
Yeah. It's actually one more parameter that indicates that you are in the right way to global minimum. Okay? It's make your It's actually only make you faster. Okay, it's not. You will converge to the same HD. Have assurance that you will converge and with momentum and without momentum to the same power minimum. We are not. The improvement only how many epochs it will take. Okay. Yeah.
How do we choose the V zero, the first V?
The first V moment.
Zero.
Yes.
Usually some initializations. Initialization. We have our selection of some parameter. So we have setting some very small parameter, essentially one exponent minus five. Empirically set default parameter. Okay. Let's forget. So, So now we talk about parameter adaptive methods. So HDD and HDD with momentum actually the same for the all parameters of our net. Yes, it's update rule that works that we apply on each of our parameters. Yeah, and actually the all parameters have the same update rule. There are a few more optimization techniques that actually have approach. Their approach is to apply on each parameter different values. Okay. So the first of them I will present is Adagrad. So Adagrad is an adaptive learning rate method that conditions each gradient element with estimation of variance making on it inversely proportional to how noisy the direction is. Okay, so we use actually some statistics on the data before we choose our update rule, our update value. Okay, RM, S, P, or P adjust the Adagrad method by using a moving average of square gradients, okay, and the third one is Adam. Adam, its method, it actually computes individual adaptive learning rates for different parameters from estimates of first and second moments of gradients. So from this optimizers. The Adam is the most successful one, okay? Because he really give us in the most neural networks he works better than HDD, and actually it's worth it to it's actually have some benefits. That is the ARM SPOP actually achieved the same results as HDD with momentum, and they are less useful.
When you say first and second moments, I mean epsilon and mu?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure. We calculate it. Yeah? It's, look, these algorithms are actually, optimizers are, they use a lot of calculations. So you have to have a good reason to use them, okay? So because you actually do a lot of calculations, so you need to have some promises that it works better. So Adam works in most of cases. Adam works better because actually he adjustable algorithm, and he you don't need to. Play with learning rate as we do in this SGD because he updates, he actually adjusts to the training process automatically. Okay? Because he calculates the gradients and he know which validator to use. So, as we talked before, perfect parameter population technique have some nice benefits. Usually their performance is more robust with respect to their happy parameters. And we have no need to check for the best learning rate, yeah, and to do a lot of experiments. And they can greatly improve the convergence speed of our algorithm. Especially in the initial epochs and iterations. But HDD with momentum optimizer is actually the common common choice, and the problem is with careful peaked learning rate. We can usually converge to a better objective value with Newton. Okay, so adapting learning rates needs to be very, very careful. Okay, great. So some tricks, hints on the trade. So some heuristics. Most of the course, using the data preprocessing, normalizing, possibly whitening, noising your data, okay, shuffling data samples each epoch, preprocessing, evaluating the ratio between the delta WT and our normalized WT. As a measure to efficient learning rate, it should be around exponent -3. Disable momentum and turn to a vanilla HD, when validation error completely flat. And the lower regularization coefficients near convergence. It's actually the tricks that we can use for avoiding divergence in the convergent. Okay. So batch normalization. One of the most popular generalization techniques that used especially for convolutional neural networks is actually batch normalization. Batch normalization works on our output features, yeah, and not on the weights. We apply it on our data. So what we actually do, we normalize the activation of each layer with statistics from that we derived from our batch. Again, when we're talking about batch, we're talking about the batch. It means the batch of pictures, the batch of samples that we used on the training process. Yeah, so. Talked about batching in the last tutorial. So we actually use for training our neural network. We use batch. We're not training sample by sample, picture by picture. We can use a bunch of pictures. Usually in classification problems. It's 1028. It's actually the nominal and the default batch size. Okay. So for each pixel, for each neuron in every batch, we actually normalize it with our statistics from the whole batch. Okay. Then we elevate a lot of head-ups with properly initialization neural networks by explicitly forcing the activation through the network to behave similar to Gaussian probabilities that we talked about before. it was actually a documentation property, and maybe possibly because of the relation is simple differential operation, it works. Okay. Sorry. Okay. So the vector relation reduces the amount what the hidden unit values shift around. This parameter is actually a covariance shift. So let's explain what is actually a covariance shift. So let's take two examples. The first examples we actually learned on the data, we learned that that's the cats, okay? And our cats are actually represented by black cats, okay? And then we actually, it's our positive samples and negative samples, okay? In the positive samples, we return our model only on the black cats, okay? And then we actually want to test it on the most validate our model with using other color red cats and grayscale cats, gray cats, okay? And in this example, we can see that then when we actually give to our model untrained samples, that actually from the same distribution, yeah, but with some variance, our model will actually predict wrong the answers because we actually very fitted for the black. Okay, the black color is actually he's very strong. It's not about black, but the colors is actually give us the model will give us wrong prediction for other color cats. So this is actually mean covariance shift learned very well for some subsets and not for the whole samples. Okay, and this is because the other cats actually have the same distribution, but some different variants. Okay, so this case, in this case, vector normalization smooth. Okay, this smooth our sample distribution and give us opportunity to and make the model to be more to be less vulnerable for this. This difference, okay? And the other benefits of Bayesian normalization that it makes a model to train faster, okay? So the Bayesian normalization is one of the very important normalizations, especially on image classification problems, because it's avoid covariance.
So if we didn't have vector normalization, what would we expect to happen?
Again, when?
If we didn't have vector normalization in this model, what would we expect to get?
No, if we didn't have the vector normalization in this example, we actually we would achieve some mispredictions because actually we are not training. We have some partitional data, partial of our data that have same distribution, but we actually needed to learn for more examples. We need to find more different examples, yeah, to make our model. To achieve better results, yeah. And in this example, we can actually train for some smaller subset of example, and it will be generalized for more samples. Actually, it makes our model to be more to be better generalized. Okay. Yeah.
Did you say that you actually applied on the outputs?
Yeah. Again. a little bit explanation about when we and when we apply the model. So batch normalization, look, we have layer, and we actually apply it on the after. Okay, it could be applied. You didn't ask me. It could be applied before or after our non-linearity. Okay, it could be applied on your multiplication of your weights on the data on the feature maps. Yeah, actually after before non-linearity or after non-linearity, and you apply it on the whole batch. Yeah, you also normalize. It's all about normalization. It's all about data normalization. Okay, so you normalize it with respect. You normalize your data with respect of batch. Yeah. Okay. I will show you after the break. I will show you. Okay. So we are talking about convolution of neural networks. First, the background: convolution of neural networks are rooted from ideas from the upcoming drug. Again, it's inspired from how the business works, visual primary cortex. The first model functional network appeared in Lacoon work from 1998 to recognize handwritten digits. It was actually the first handwritten digits data set. It was Ernest and his network named Linet. Yeah, it's actually the basic and very, very shallow convolutional neural network. The big explosion of convolutional neural networks was on when in competition of ImageNet. ImageNet is actually one of the most popular datasets. It's a dataset of 1,000 of images, classification of 1,000 images. So this competition, powered by Kaggle, on the big dataset platforms. AlexNet, that it's actually a convolutional neural network by Alex Krzyzewski and the famous Jeffrey Hinton. Actually, Jeffrey Hinton is one of the godfathers of the fathers of the neural network, the pathologist too. So, AlexNet was the first real success of the convolutional neural network. It achieved results that was times better than the other that actually using computer vision techniques classification. So we actually for 6 years that convolutional neural networks are very popular, and there are a lot of evaluation of AlexNet that made from data based for now. We will talk about it in a few minutes. So what actually we do in convolutional neural networks actually is based on spatial convolution. So natural images have a property that many patches share statistical properties and can often be described as fairly small set of the same features. So this suggests that the features that we learn in one part of the image can also be applied to other parts of the image, and we can use the same features at all locations. Okay, this is why the property that used in computer vision and the image related tests. Let's see how we convolve. So for example, we have learning features of a small 5x5 feature, okay? So some feature, so sample from the image, we can then convolve them with larger image, okay? So this is obtaining a different feature activation value at each location in the image, okay? So the first one, actually, is the red one is the convolved feature, and the our original image was the green one, as the convolution, the values of the convolution that we made is actually, you can see the red ones on the, it's actually what the our filters that we use, okay? Great. So it's actually multiplication filter on the image. We, okay. So convention and terminology, 2D grids that represent image space are called feature maps, okay? Each value in the feature map represents information about specific locations on input images, okay? And our the parameters learned from each convolution layer also called 2D, two-dimensional map, usually called caravans or filters. Okay? So convolution can have strides, moving the filter with a fixed step and padding, adding zeros to values to avoid special size decrease. Again, when we want actually to reduce the dimension from one feature map to other feature map, we use bigger stride. Yeah? In this way, we actually get a smaller output. Any questions about this? About padding? We actually padded our contours for it actually make us for make convolution on edge. Okay? Oh, great, your profusion. So convolutional okay, we talked about. So bias values are added per map. Then actually, the number of bias elements is the number of output feature maps. Each feature map has a bias.
Okay. So it's the number of channels. So it's the number of channels for each
feature. Yes. Yes. The number of channels for each feature. Okay. Okay. So we have our forward function. So for our input x is in the dimension of n by n multiple w multiple height, it's actually the number of channels and multiple the size of our picture, where the number of feature maps, each special size of our feature in w multiple h, we wish to correlate them with weight that here actually from a space m multiple n multiple multiple k multiple k, okay, different filter size that we actually setting here, number of feature maps and number of filter size, and we actually have our y output. So it's calculated this way, and then when we actually calculate our first output feature map, yeah, we and our bias. So each output feature map have one bias. Yes.
So
anyone?
The bias for each feature map is identical for all pixels?
Yes. Okay. So it's also could be expressed sum of m two dimensional convolutions. We are doing it actually this way. We have y output feature map, m is dimensional of our output on our next layer, and the n is the number of feature maps that we have in the image. Okay? And then we actually assign it everything. Okay, so convolution layer can be specific configuration of fully connected layer. So if actually if our size of feature map and our size of filter are the same, yeah, we actually get the ratio of your connect. Am I right?
It's a subtle of your connect.
What? Because we actually the special size of the kernels are smaller than the size of the features. Yeah. Because in full connect we have we multiply all layer, all inputs all outputs. Okay? So we have actually all connections. Here we have only a few connections. Okay? So, local connectivity units, it's a subsequent layer are connected only to a smaller subset of previous layer. Yeah, it's actually not have a lot of all connections because if you have a fully connected. And share weights, it's weights that are used to extract information are shared across all special locations. Okay.
Why does shared weights
work? Why it works? Okay, so the shared weight.
Because if you use shared weights, it means it doesn't matter what the object is in the image as long as it exists.
Yeah. Because you're not.
Shared weights says that if you have an object here or if you have an object somewhere else in the picture, it doesn't really matter.
Did it clear? Okay. So, when we use convolution network, we actually have to use pooling. Okay, pooling layers is actually layers that help us to reduce in special size. Okay? So, to describe a large image, one natural approach is to aggregate systems of features in various locations. For example, one could compute the mean or max value of a particular feature over region of the image. Okay? So, we actually have our feature, we take our feature map and only give opportunity to the maximum values, to the maximum values. Of the features to continue to the next layer, okay? Because we actually think that this data give us the information about our feature, okay? The best information about our feature. So. Let's take an example. So if we actually have a single feature map two dimension, and we actually want to decrease it by 4, okay? So it's max pooling, okay? So we in each square we take only the maximum data, okay? So in the first one we take only 6, in the second we take 8, and etc. And then we have actually from this feature map we get a factor feature map that have only the maximum data, the first one, okay? This is actually max pooling layer, okay? It's reduced. The spatial size, but okay. Is it clear? Okay. So, pooling dimension serves two main purposes. One is dimensional reduction. Pooling is usually done with strides bigger than one, yeah, because we want to reduce our spatial size. Also, the variance to transformation of pooling. Actually, a special area to single point. We allow small invariance to location and deformation. Okay, this is also reduce the ability to overfit on specific image. Yeah, because if we have some image, we actually want to reduce the overfitting. So we actually do it by shell power, by reduce of some connector, reduce of something. So, pooling functions. So the max pooling taking the maximum element from the pooled area, the average pooling taking the average of the pooled area, okay? And we have stochastic pooling and fractional pooling and LP, some LP pooling, the normalization pooling, but the most useful one, the first options, max pooling and average pooling, they actually give us the same inference. Okay, they eventually get the same results in the case. The most popular choice. Great. So now we start convolutional neural networks. So how it works? So we have our input. Our input is from the pixel domain because we are talking about pixels. Yeah, and then we actually starting to convolve them. Yeah, first we make some convolutions, and then we do some subsampling. How we do subsampling? By pooling. Yeah, we do subsampling by pooling. We actually from now where we actually starting to convolve our features, we actually convert our work from pixel domain to feature map domain. Okay, in this domain, in feature map domain, we want to have only the feature data for classification. Okay, we actually want to have only the sufficient division data for classification that will help us to classify as accurate as we can. Okay, so there we have subsampling. Then we apply our non-linearity, and second stage we actually do the same one things, and then we are getting to a classification process, and we're doing by first apply for fully connection there, and then we actually do the softmax on our output features, because we want the probability to be from 0 to 1, because we want to classify it to some one hot vector and to get classification prediction. Is it clear? Guys, is it clear? Yeah, great. So actually we have reduction in our special domain till we get feature one by one.
What is the reason for convolving a one by one kernel?
In which here?
Yeah.
So the reason is actually to you can avoid it. It's actually an example for reducing domain in it's one of the way. Here it's one of the way to reduce to avoid using full connector. Okay, you can reduce using full connector by applying one by one. Okay, we strike. Okay,
and it also allows you to generalize a net you trained on a single size image and to apply it to larger images.
Yeah,
if you're using it in a
large
model.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. So, what do convolutional neural network learn? So, it actually learn. We started with talking about feature extraction domain. So, if we are starting from, we have actually feeding our input data, feature of car. Yeah? So, low level feature maps is actually the first. Convolutional neural networks are actually learn some rough presentation. Okay, they're very. It's some very low-level representation, low-level regions of our region. Okay, and then when we continue in the and actually feeding our feature map by convolving and reduction and sampling and the feature and the feature map reduction, we actually get more and more data that actually give us as similar to our to our original feature, okay, to our original time picture. So here in high level pictures we can actually see the parts of our you can see the parts of our car. Okay, so it's I think it's a car. Yeah, it's a little bit. Okay, great.
How do you visualize those?
How do I visualize it? You actually apply it on you actually apply the feature on the original. You apply your feature indexes. Yes, on the on your original. Okay. You actually extract your feature. Okay. You visualize it.
How do you do it?
Okay. The question. Your question was. Was how do I visualize this? Okay, I do actually. I'm sorry. I actually do the upsampling. Okay. How do upsampling? Actually, look. The first step was downsampling. Yeah. Then I get our compression. Representation. Then actually I can upsample it to original data and then to visualize it. Okay? Great. So Alexander was the first popularized convolutional neural network computer vision work that actually achieved the best classification accuracy on ImageNet, and this network consists of 60 million parameters and 8 trainable layers. Okay, it was 5 convolutional neural networks, 5 convolutional neural layers, and 3 fully connected layers. Okay. The Google Net is actually they was the winner of Kaggle competition in 2014. So Google Net proposed use smaller convolutions filters and using average pooling, and they actually increased the number of layers. Up to 10. Okay, so this is actually using one-by-one convolution dramatically reduced the number of parameters in the neural network, 5 million compared to 16 million it was in AlexNet. Why do you think it happens? Why it happens? How will it reduce the number of parameters?
Reducing fully connected layers.
Yeah, you actually avoid here using 3 fully connected because fully connected there actually have a lot of parameters. Yeah, so we avoid using 2 fully connected and use wide-by-wide convolutional filters in part of them. Yeah, it consists of 1/1 and 3/3, and then we actually get a more deeper network with 5 million parameters. So it achieved us to have a more accurate network with small number of parameters and to get better results. Okay. So Google later improved this network by introducing bayesian normalization, as we talked about, and different exceptional configuration. We will not talk about it right now. So Google Net actually it's the architecture. So they have previous. This is the previous layer, so we have convolutional we have one line of evolutions. Actually, we do it in parallel. We have one by one, and then we have we applied on our feature map one by one evolution 3x3, 1x1 and 5x5, and we do actually apply pooling 3x3, and then an evolution by one by one, and then we actually concatenate these values in filter in one filter concatenation, and then we actually apply on we going to the next apply. Okay. Great. So VGG. VGG. They are run up in this is what the demos run up in the same competition as GoogleNet. They actually present the work by Karen Simeon and Andrew Zisselman. The main contribution of their network was the showing that the depth of the network is critical component for good performance. Okay? So they actually, VGG have a few settings, and they have 16 layers and 18 layers of depth. Okay? Their best network contains 16 training layers. Okay? So they have features are an extremely homogeneous architecture that only performs 3x3 convolution and 2x2 pullings from beginning to the end. So despite its slightly weaker classification performance, the VGG component features outperform this of GoogleNet in multiple transfer learning tasks.
What does it mean, multiple transfer learning tasks?
Thank you for asking. Transfer learning task is actually out of scope of this lecture, but transfer learning task is when you want to apply your feature maps for a multiple tasks. So if you want to classify use one feature map domain to classify and to detect some feature, okay? So you want to do two. You want not only do one classification task. You want to do some multiple tasks. Okay. But we will talk about transfer learning using transfer learning in the next class. Okay. But actually, it using one set of parameters for solving few tasks. Okay. And not only for classifying tasks. Okay. Do some other things, okay? this is what actually training VGG is very expensive because it has a lot of parameters. It has 114 million parameters. So how do you estimate the time it will take to train VGG on the single modern GPU? Anyone?
Longer.
No, I asked if you have some estimation of time it will take.
Week,
yes. Week is a good estimation. So training VGG takes on single modern GPU a week. Single modern GPU costs thousands of dollars. Okay, so you will actually have you using the powerful GPU model. You need 1 week for training VGG. So it's taking a lot of time. Okay, so now I will present you the residual neural networks. The residual neural networks is actually, I think it's the most useful convolutional neural networks. From 2015 till now, there are no another new concept neural network that actually beat this idea. This is the best idea till now, yeah, that we actually can use because it has a few details, information. Okay. So first, let's talk about. Okay, it's features a very deep architectures. Yeah, it's present in the residual neural network. You can actually to have up to, they present 152 layers, okay? And look, there, and with some special skip connections and using a heavy using operation normalization, we can actually add more layers and not be overfitted, okay? So now we present some problem that we have. If we take some VGG style networks, so networks that have a lot of parameters, but they have a lot of layers. So what actually happens in these networks? It's a phenomenon that calls vanishing gradient. Guys, sorry, it's, it can be a little bit wide. So, yeah. The problem with VGG style networks that when we have a lot of parameters, and our network is very deep, it's very deep, we actually have in our network phenomena that's called vanishing gradients. Okay, vanishing gradients. Vanishing gradients. It's actually what's actually happened in vanishing gradients. Vanishing gradients. Your gradients are actually very small. Yeah, and when they're very small, you can learn. You can. It's actually unlearned parameters. Yeah, you can learn. It's not vanishing gradients, you are not contribute to your update. Yeah? So why it happens? Why it happens why do you think it happens in very depth VGG like networks?
Because if, for example, your working bias is not smaller than one, that you probably not only edit it.
Can you speak louder, please?
If your working bias is not smaller than one.
Okay.
Well,
yes, you're right, but it's actually the it's phenomenon that causes but some problem.
It's usually in, for example,
there are a few explanations of this phenomenon, but I think the main reason is because you have actually when you have a lot of layers and you have a lot of dropouts between the layers, the contribution of each parameter in the previous layers are very small. Okay, they are not very strong connections between layer and layer. Okay, it's actually because you actually we lost the connection. Okay, and when we lost the connection, we lost the opportunity to reach our data, to reaching our feature maps by new information, and then we actually our gradients, our calculation of gradients are very small. There are no strong dependencies between the layers. When we VGG like very deep neural networks, a lot of parameters are actually not learned. Okay, so it's phenomenon that happens in overparameterized algorithms. So then we actually represent residual neural networks. It's actually a skip connection layer. It's when we actually have our input x, okay, and then we have some weighted layer, and then we have apply a rule, and here we concatenate the identity x that we have with actually our function. We have our function x. And then we actually adding some previous layer information. So in this case, we're actually enriching our data by some previous information. Okay? This way, we actually concentrate our data, make it more powerful, to strengthen our dependencies between the layers, between the feature. feature map extraction. So in this case, in this skeptical connection gives us opportunity to add a lot of blocks, a lot of layers, and not be overfitting on them, because you actually, by increasing the number of parameters, you actually only increase your accuracy by achieving better globally. Okay. So, is this is skip connection idea is clear? Yeah.
I didn't get it. You inputting some of the input features to the last layer or last.
We have the previous layer feature map. Then we are actually applying our convolutional method on the next layer, and then we actually enrich the concatenate the previous data with the convolved data with the next feature map extraction data, and then we have actually more dense representation of our feature map.
It's kind of you're using the features at different levels.
Yes.
In
yes.
order to
yes,
do your
yes.
last prediction.
Yes. Yes. You're right. So after this work, there are a few more works that actually apply the same idea, but in different way. Most one of them is DenseNet. So DenseNet applying the same idea by connecting the information of previous five layers. Okay. Here on one, they apply five layers, so they concatenate five layers, and actually memory, they have some memory, they collect memory from the five layers, yeah? And the some other work is actually, they have three layers, but all of them are actually use this idea of concatenating the previous data and the future next data, yeah.
Does it relate to recurrent net? Does it
No, it's not related to recurrent net. Recurrent net is actually maybe this the idea. No, it's not really. It's not really recurrent.
Is it concatenating or adding?
Okay, this is adding. This is adding, but you in some cases you are concatenating too. Okay, but you actually it's some operations adding. In most cases, they use concatenation and adding two. Okay, but the most I think the first work are make add. Okay. Yeah.
So you can also extend it by doing the very same like pooling or stuff to X, and then you can you just need to. To save the same dimensions of F and X and X, right? So you can do this for more layers.
Yeah, sure.
Maybe capture.
Sure. This is block skip connection block. You can apply.
Yeah.
You can apply by then you can apply base normalization pooling. It's actually like a block that you actually add between layers. Okay. So it's actually way to it's way to concatenate your network. Yeah. It's actually a way that you're adding your layers. You add your layers by this algorithm.
So
okay?
This is how you can capture a lot of local
you capture a lot of local data.
Yeah.
And then you can apply it, of course, based on normalization. That was the first thing that we do. It works well. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it's the last. So few more minutes. Some trends in designing CNNs, guys. It's our last slide, so we did it. The using smaller convolutional kernels, 3x3 is very dominant in the convolutional neural network architectures. When we go deeper, using smaller kernels is rectified by stacking more layers, effectively increasing the receptive field of the neural network. Less pooling, going deeper. It means that we need to reduce our spatial size very carefully. without applying very hard, very high factor of pulling, will actually in this case we can actually cut the interesting points of actually the useful data, yes, that for our classification problem. So do it very carefully, okay, in very small steps, okay. So modern neural network have smaller number of pooling, and their part of them they're not using pooling at all, okay, because preserve the special domain very could be very efficient for good classification. For better classification. Or if we're talking about regression problems, we are not using specific pooling at all because it's very hard for our performance. So search for the best convolutional layers. Searching for best convolutional layers is actually algorithm that finding the best convolutional neural network set. This way we actually learn which convolutional layer we need to use for end-to-end, for getting the best accuracy. So it's the last, NASNet is the NASNet architecture, they are winner the last Kaggle competition, and the last competition, it was actually the last competition for Kaggle for ImageNet, for now it will be other task, but they achieved, they present architectures with hundreds of layers, they present version for hundreds of layers, and they achieve, I think, they achieve 93 or 94 accuracy on top one. It's actually incredible. Now, and using evolutionary AutoML to discover neural networks architecture. About evolutionary AutoML, I will talk about it some of my next lectures. It's actually a very exciting field, and this way we actually using the neural networks to discover genetics algorithms to discover new neural networks. Okay. So and the most the actually the last Google work is Ameba Net, okay, and they actually they trained CNN architecture to achieve notable results for 7 hours. Their network training 7 hours, and they achieved really state-of-the-art results. So we talked about one week for B2G and 7 hours for Omega. Thank you. See you next time.